to thee. For all the dangers, toils, and snares that he has brought me out, he is my God, and I'll serve thee.
No matter what the test,
trust and never doubt, Jesus will surely bring you out.
At rest, I'm going home to be forever blessed.
Trust and never doubt,
Jesus will surely bring you out. He never failed me yet.
I will sing of His mercy
every day.
He gives me power.
My God delivered Moses from King Pharaoh, and didn't he cool the fiery furnace for Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego? When I think of what my God can do, He delivered Daniel. I know He will deliver you.
Trust
Him and never doubt.
Never doubt. He never failed me. He never failed me.
Even in the storm.
He never failed me. He never failed me.
God will never fail you.
Trust and never doubt. Jesus will surely bring you out.
Good morning, and welcome to worship at Woods Memorial Presbyterian Church. I'm glad you're with us today. Just a reminder that next Sunday, October 4th, is World Communion Sunday. Next Sunday, we will be observing the sacrament of the Lord's Supper with Christians around the world. So prepare your bread and your cup for virtual communion next week. Today, let's begin with a word of prayer. Merciful God, we've come today to worship you. We pray, give us the same attitude as Jesus, who emptied himself and was obedient to you all the way to his death on the cross. Today, make us eager to serve you, to put others' good ahead of our own and their needs before our needs. We ask this through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Holy Spirit, come and fill this place with your presence. Embolden us to spread the fire of your Spirit. This day may we devote ourselves to teaching and prayer. And let us pray as Saint Augustine. Breathe in us, O Holy Spirit, that our thoughts may all be holy. Act in us, O Holy Spirit, that our work too may be holy. Draw our hearts, O Holy Spirit, that we love but what is holy. Strengthen us, O Holy Spirit, to defend all that is holy. Guard us then, O Holy Spirit, that we always may be holy. May we never cease to be amazed at your works, and may we always remember that you are with us. Amen.
Please join me in the call to worship. The Apostle Paul wrote, "Beloved, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any consolation in love, any sharing in the Spirit, any compassion and sympathy, make my joy complete. Be of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind." Let us pray. Gracious God, how shall we do your will today? Will it be in acts of praise, in gifts shared, in prayers lifted? Who will you teach us to serve? Help us trust you. Help us listen. Bless our community as we join our voices in worship. Encourage us, remind us, unite us, make our joy complete. Amen.
Come live in the light, shine with the joy and the love of the Lord. We are called to be light for the kingdom, to live in the freedom of the city of God. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Come, open your heart. Show your mercy to all those in fear. We are called to be hope for the hopeless, so hatred and violence will be no more. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God. Sing, sing a new song. Sing of that great day when all will be one. God will reign, and we'll walk with each other as sisters and brothers, united in love. We are called to act with justice. We are called to love tenderly. We are called to serve one another, to walk humbly with God.
All too often, we tell God we will do better and that we will be better, and then we just go on living the same ways that we always have. Let this be the moment, the time when we change, when we confess to God our failures and our faithlessness so that we can go forth to work in God's kingdom of grace and hope. Join me now in our prayer of confession. We want to be fountains of hope for others, O God of glory, but too often people find that our hearts are hardened. We'd like to be transformed people, but our stubborn pride prevents us from bending a knee to you. We long to stand with those who are in need, but our selfishness keeps our backs rigid in judgment. Forgive us, God, who came down to us in Jesus Christ. Forgive us. Humble us that we might be true servants to the broken and the lost. Split open our hardened and frozen hearts that compassion might flow freely to those who are hurting. Fill our minds with the presence of your Spirit that we might learn how to follow Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior, into that kingdom of grace and hope. Amen. Friends, this is the good news. In Christ, God's plan for salvation has been accomplished. We are forgiven. We are made new. We are completing God's joy by sharing compassion and forgiveness and hope with everyone we meet. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Hey guys, I'm Elizabeth. I'm so excited to be here with you. I am the Director of Youth Ministry here at Woods Church, and today we get to be outside. I hope that you get a chance to go outside today and have a great time. You know, I was thinking before the weather gets really cold, in October and September, we still get to go sailing and motorboating and out on the river and out in the bay. And I was thinking about when I was growing up, I went and spent my whole summer on the river down in North Carolina. And I loved it because I got to be a part of a sailing team. And maybe some of you went to sailing camp, or perhaps some of you went and learned how to sail with your family. Well, my family, we would go to camp and learn how to sail. And you know, when you want to be on a racing team, you got to learn exactly how to do it, right? You need to learn where the wind is coming from. You need to learn how to position yourself and how to come about. What we would do is we practice, and sometimes we really would win. And it was amazing because people cheer for you and they give you a medal, and it's the best. Sometimes we capsize and whoops, we didn't come first. And other times, well, we definitely didn't win because the wind wasn't in our favor. But it was the best when we could come in first place. Obviously, everyone wants to come in first. So I was thinking about that when I was reading my Bible this week, because I was reading from Mark's Gospel, and it was a story from Jesus. It was a weird one because the disciples, they were arguing, and maybe you and your brother or sister, you argue with each other. And as they were arguing, Jesus turns around. He's like, guys, what is up? What are you doing? And the disciples are like, well, we don't know. How do you get to heaven? What's the best way? How do you win? How do you get up there? And Jesus says, well, the first will be last, and the last will be first. And I decided that what Jesus is telling us is that getting to heaven doesn't mean that you did it because you're the best Christian or you were the best at being Jesus' disciple. What it means is that you thought of other people first. You let other people go before you. So you were kind and you loved one another. And that's what it means to Jesus to be a disciple of Christ, to love one another, to share Christ's love and be an example to other people so that they can treat each other the way that, you know, we want to be treated. So it was a little different, but I definitely learned something new. So I encourage you to go find this passage in Mark and learn more about what it means to be a disciple of Christ. Let us pray. Dear God, we thank you for your Bible, for teaching us what it means to be a disciple of Christ. Be with us as we move forward and remind us that we are each loved by you. Amen.
Let me be your silence. Let me be your shout. Let me be your riches where poverty cries out. Let me be your ocean that brings the waves of change, the tiny cloud in desert drought that brings the pouring rain. Let me be the weakness that shows your strength so clear. Let me be your whisper shouting grace for all to hear. Let me be your stillness that moves peace in place of doubt. So let me be your silence. Let me be your shout. Let me be. Let me be. Let me be the grace of God. Or let me be. Let me be. Let me be. Let me be the quill and ink of words you've yet to pen. Let me be your bread that feeds the hungry souls of men. Let me be your rushing wind that cools the blistered heart. Let me be the canvas on which anguish turns to art. Let me. Let me be. Let me be the grace of God. Oh, let me be. Let me be. Let me be your silence. Let me be your shout. Your shout.
And now we turn our hearts and our hearing to God's word in Scripture. Let us pray. Lord God, we give you thanks that you come to us through your word. We ask that we might be blessed by these words so that we are renewed and refreshed and transformed. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Reading from the Gospel according to Mark. Then they came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house, he asked them, "What were you arguing about on the way?" But they were silent, for on the way they had argued with one another who was the greatest. He sat them down, called the 12, and said to them, "Whoever wants to be first must be last of all and servant of all." Here ends this reading.
We are continuing with our fall sermon series called The Beloved Community. Today we're in the second chapter of Paul's letter to the Philippians. In the first chapter, Paul shared his love and gratitude for the kindness of the Philippian church and explained how even in his imprisonment had served to advance the gospel of Jesus Christ. Now Paul begins to speak directly to the Philippian situation. He urges them to lead lives worthy of the gospel of Jesus, to stand firm in one spirit, working side by side with one mind. Here is Philippians chapter 2, beginning at verse 3. "Do nothing for selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Let each of you look not to your own interests, but to the interests of others. Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not regard equality with God as something to be exploited, but emptied himself, taking the form of a slave. Being born in human likeness and being found in human form, he humbled himself and became obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. Therefore, God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bend in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God." They are iconic, these words that we return to again and again and again. "The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want." "The Word became flesh and dwelt among us, full of grace and truth." "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus." These words are like a favorite song that we can't stop singing, an anthem sung to the glory of the risen Christ by Paul from the darkness of his prison cell. These verses are, in fact, a hymn, a praise song sung to the glory of God the Son, who, though equal with God in every way, humbled himself, emptied himself of all advantage and privilege, and became a servant, a slave of all. Now, nearly everyone agrees that these are not Paul's original words, but actually the words to a song, an ancient anthem that Paul sang with the Philippians when they were in worship together. Possibly it was a song they taught him during the time that he shared with the beloved community in Philippi. Now, from the confinement of his prison cell, Paul bursts into song, calling the believers in Philippi and you and me to assume that same attitude of joy. "Let the same mind be in you that was in Christ Jesus." Dr. Fred Craddock points out that even though Paul calls the believers to take on the mind and outlook of Christ, he doesn't expect them to agree on everything. Far from it. Instead, he is urging them to share a common attitude, to have the same love. He wrote, "Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than yourselves. Something was going on in the beloved community. There was some sort of disagreement or division. What do you suppose they were arguing about? Was it theology? Were they having a disagreement over circumcision or baptism? Maybe it was about worship. You know, they had to figure out how to blend the Jewish practices of worship that they used when they were down by the river with what was now a mostly Greek community, not Jewish. Were there problems about race? Philippi was a very diverse community. Or were they socioeconomic? Some of the members of the Philippian church were slaves. Some were soldiers. Others were business owners. They came from all walks of life, and that was great. But were some of them saying or implying, my walk of life is better than your walk of life? We don't know. We don't know what their disagreements were, but we know they had them. Because woven through all of this is a call to unity, a call to be of one mind, a call to humility, and to lay down one's own life, one's own opinions and preferences for the good of the other. Paul had a deep affection for the Philippians, and when they weren't getting along, it weighed heavy on his heart. We know a little something about rancor and division, don't we? Our national situation is marinated in anxiety and bitterness and antagonism. And it can be much more personal than political. When members of a family aren't getting along, the whole family suffers the strain. And when a church, any church, is experiencing conflict, well, you can feel the tension. Sometimes you don't even want to be there. Is that what was happening in Philippi? In chapter 4, Paul calls on two of the key leaders of the church in Philippi, Eudonia and Syntyche, to be of the same mind in the Lord. Now, he's not asking them to think the same way. He's not even expecting them to agree. He's instructing them, and all of us, to take on the mind of Christ, to assume the humility of Christ, the self-emptying love of Christ. Not just with regard to their disagreement, but in everything. He said, have the same mind in you that was in Christ Jesus, who humbled himself, taking the form of a servant. We could use some of that humility in our present situation. It's time. It's time for us to admit humbly that no individual or group among us has all the answers, and that we need each other. God designed us to live in community, and we find life's greatest fulfillment in serving God and serving others. Now, in the church, we strive to do that, and most of the time we do a really good job. But our culture rewards bombacity and self-centeredness, and anxiety is thick in much of what we do. I wonder whatever happened to humility and self-emptying love. Did you see A Beautiful Day in the Neighborhood, the film? If you didn't, it's worth a watch. I thought it was a kid's movie because Tom Hanks plays Fred Rogers, the television icon. But in fact, the film is about servanthood and humility and the power of compassion. Matthew Rhys plays journalist Lloyd Vogel. He works for Esquire magazine, and he's assigned to do a profile piece on Fred Rogers. He doesn't want to do it. His life's a mess. He's tangled in a blistering battle with his father that's wrecking his health and straining his marriage. And Lloyd, well, he sets out to reveal that Fred Rogers is a fake and a fraud. But Fred Rogers' compassion, his Christ-centered humility and plain decency turn the whole thing on its ear. It all reminds me of Paul's challenge to the Philippians. Let the same mind be in you that was in Jesus. For those who follow Christ, it has never been about winning the day or proving ourselves right. It's always been about giving ourselves away. The call of Christ is always to humility. Humility and service. But you know, I don't think that humility is all that popular today. Maybe it never has been. For example, how many parents do you know that when they show you their newborn say to you, yes, yes, so beautiful, and someday this child is going to grow up to be humble? What they should say is, someday this child is going to grow up to make me humble. I think that a lot of the reason that most of us don't embrace humility as a virtue is that we equate it with low self-esteem, when in fact, true humility, Christ-like humility, requires very strong self-esteem. Self-esteem that doesn't come from praise or achievement, but from the authentic experience of loving and being loved. I saw this very clearly a few years ago when I was seated at a dinner event next to the late New Testament scholar and celebrated author Marcus Borg. And I learned about this seating arrangement several days ahead of the event, and honestly, I panicked. I was scared to death that I might not have something meaningful to say to this great man. So I frantically read everything that Dr. Borg had recently written, and that was no small trick. He wrote a lot. I arrived that night armed with a mental list of insightful comments and questions, and he answered them succinctly. But he kept changing the subject, steering the conversation away from his own work. Do you know what he wanted to talk about? He wanted to talk about you. He wanted to know all about you. He kept asking me questions about this church, about what you love and what you're good at, your history and your plans. In his speech that night, Dr. Borg said, I'm a teacher. I work in an ivory tower. But you who serve the church, you are on the front lines of God's work of liberation, our exodus. God's will for the world is reconciliation and forgiveness. God wills that we see ourselves and each other as beloved. God wills resurrection, not just individual personal salvation, but the redemption of God's whole creation. That's what you're doing in the church. You are participating in the salvation of God. I went away that night humbled, but also inspired by this great scholar's definition of the beloved community. Dr. King described the beloved community as individuals and groups engaging in acts of self-sacrifice and Christ-like love. these acts of courage and sacrifice stir the national and global imagination and inspire legal and constitutional steps toward justice and equality for all. This is how God chooses to redeem a fallen world, through the love of ordinary people, looking not to our own interests, but to the interests of others, seeking to have the same mind that was in Christ Jesus, who, though he was God, emptied himself, taking the form and role of a servant, offering up his life as a sacrifice for the whole world. Last weekend, while I was writing that line about servanthood and sacrifice, a message came across my screen saying, "Women, if you have a credit card in your own name and your own credit history, if you have ever leased an apartment or bought property in your own name, if you have ever consented to your own medical treatment, or if you have played a sport in school, you can thank Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg." Not 5 minutes later, another message from another Woods member appeared. She wrote, "Tonight I'll mourn, but tomorrow I'm going to wake up and fight for the world of John Lewis and Ruth Bader Ginsburg." You know, you don't have to agree with their politics and policies or decisions, but you got to admire Justice Ginsburg and Congressman Lewis in their spirit of service and sacrifice. Hard work and humility made them great. And there are many more such models. Across the centuries and across the miles, Paul's wisdom is remarkably applicable to our national situation. He calls us to do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility regard others as better than ourselves. Let each of us look not to our own interests, but to the interest of others. Paul is simply echoing what Jesus taught, what he taught his disciples when he heard them arguing about who was the greatest. We do that too, don't we? We size up each other. We push and tussle for position. Is that what was happening with Eudonia and Syntyche in Philippi? Jesus said to his disciples, "Stop it. Whoever wants to be first needs to be last and servant of all." Or as Dr. King said, "Anyone can be great because anyone can serve." Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit. Paul doesn't say don't have ambition. Of all the apostles, Paul was probably the most ambitious. But Paul's ambition was not for himself and his own goals. It was for Christ. Paul's ambition was to have the mind of Christ. And he calls every one of us to embody that same attitude when we are imitating Christ, imitating his ambition for God's kingdom reign, showing our attitude toward others as Christ-like, the very way that we look out for others first and place others' needs ahead of our own. I love the way that tennis great Arthur Ashe talked about glory. He said, "True heroism is remarkably sober, very undramatic. It is not the urge to surpass all others at whatever cost, but the urge to serve others at whatever cost." And I see that so clearly in the members of this church who regularly give yourselves away on behalf of others. There are so many. like the chaperones who stay up all night at winter relief, and the teachers who devote themselves selflessly to their students. I see true heroism in volunteers who work with ministries of love and justice like ACT, changing the systems that keep people in poverty and helping people help themselves to build a better life. These are heroes, and there are so many more. Have the same mind in you that was in Christ Jesus. Jesus' ambition was not for his own glory. Instead, he emptied himself, taking the form of a servant. And because he did, today we sing an anthem to his glory. For God also highly exalted him and gave him the name that is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bend, in heaven and on earth and under the earth, and every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. This is my ambition for Woods Church, that we will be found faithful to the mind of Christ, the servant attitude of Christ, the humility of Jesus Christ, and his glory. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Before you.
let's join our voices as we say what we believe using the portion from a brief statement of faith printed on your screen. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus proclaimed the reign of God, preaching good news to the poor and release to the captives, teaching by word and deed and blessing the children, healing the sick and binding up the brokenhearted, eating with outcasts, forgiving sinners, and calling all to repent and believe in the gospel. Unjustly condemned for blasphemy and sedition, Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal.
Hi, my name is Tom Weisinger. My family has been members of Woods for 16 years. Our family has changed a lot in that time. Kids grow up, move away, move back home, but Woods has always been there for us. The leaders and teachers and friends have been the foundation of our faith. We give to Woods so that foundation remains strong. We give to Woods because through this church, we can have a vision of our lives that goes beyond our family, one that impacts others and the world. Please pray with me. Heavenly Father, in difficult times like these, we worry, we doubt, we may even hate. But your Son taught us to love above all. Through him, love, forgiving, not judging, serving others, not taking for yourself, will be the new pandemic. Lord, thank you for your blessings of your Son and for all that you have given us in our lives. Please bless these, our gifts to you, the church, and our community. May the act of giving help infect us and others with your everlasting peace. Amen.
Fear that Let us pray. Holy God, you who are the health of the sick, the comfort of the sad, rebuke of the oppressor, judge of the greedy, hope of the repentant, and friend of the depressed, in prayer we lift up to you this world with its outrageous injustices, yet also its outpouring of human kindness from ordinary and yet extraordinary people. Loving God, let your blessing be upon those who serve their neighbors without thought of reward, who forgive their enemies 70 times 7, who care for broken strangers as if they were their dearest friends, who weep with the bereaved as if they were sisters, who heal the diseased, not counting the risk to themselves. Let your blessing encourage those who work for peace when the only result seems to be more violence, who preach and live the gospel in the face of persecution, who feed the hungry although their efforts get misinterpreted, who stand up for the downtrodden in spite of public scorn, and who maintain the church when those around belittle it. Holy God, please reach out your hand over each of us gathered here now, that our faith may be enlarged and fortified, our vision enlightened and extended, and our compassion refreshed and widened. This week, Lord, we pray for those who stand for justice in the face of hatred, who lift up their voices for those whose voices fall silent. We remember this week especially the life of Justice Ruth Bader Ginsburg. We pray that she be an example whose light shines so bright that no darkness can snuff it out. Let her be an example for the generations to come. And Lord, we pray each week for the members of Woods who seek your care, for Sue Brayman, Jean Campbell, Carly Dent and Zelma Gossard, Ted Lewis, Jeff and Linda Norris, Joan Rohrbeck, Marilyn Sickles, Charlene Van Meter, and Robin Williams. We lift up in care Dave Bremer, Peter Cooper, Bob Downey, Shirley and Griff Hall, Alan Lupfer, Tom Page, Edie Segree, Suzanne Taylor, Ann and John Beach, and Jeff Wood. Lord, we pray for Betty Butler, Carolyn Decker, Carl Erickson, Art Johnson, Corinne Minton, B. Perry, Marie Sheldon, Margot Thiel, and Janet Wallace. Lord, our congregation grieves and comforts the family and friends of Helen Drugman and the friends and family of Jack Myhill. We pray each week for our mission partners here in Severna Park and around the country, as well as internationally, for our partners in Guatemala and Mexico, in Cuba and Malawi. And we pray especially, Lord, for those who put their lives in the face of danger, for first responders and military personnel, for volunteers who respond to crises. Lord, we ask for all of these things, the many blessings of our lives to be given and lifted to you. Through the name of Jesus of Nazareth, whose love was good enough for the simple, too much for the proud and powerful and absolutely amazing for all who shared his cup. And now we pray the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Streams of mercy. songs of Thou's praise. Teach me some melodious sonnet, sung by flaming tongues above. Praise the mountain fixed upon it, Mount of God's unchanging love. Here I raise my Ebenezer, hither by thy help I'm come, and I hope by thy good pleasure safely to arrive at home. Jesus sought me when a stranger, wandering from the fold of God. He's to rescue me from danger, interposed his precious blood. Oh, to grace how great a debtor daily I'm constrained to be. Let thy grace now like a fetter bind my wandering heart to thee. Prone to wander, Lord, I feel it, prone to leave the God I love. Here's my heart, oh, take and seal it for thy courts above.
And now, beloved, may the God of peace, who brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, make you complete in everything good, so that you may do God's will, working among us that which is pleasing in God's sight, through Jesus Christ, to whom be the glory forever and ever. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Alleluia. Amen.